Welcome to my channel. You two can be great, 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 great guys. This is the Love and Hip Hop New York Season 10, Episode 3, Keeping Up with the Joneses Review. The episode begins with Chrissy Kimpella and Juju B in a car, driving somewhere. I don't know where the hell they were going, but the whole point is Chrissy's discussing the fact that she's going to have to meet with people and kind of explain the circumstances as to why she's in foreclosure, even though she's working in real estate. Juju B expresses interest in being part of the real estate business, the Lady Millionaires, because this is something that she's familiar with. Freaking Kimbella, she is useless in this entire situation. She's a useless. She brings nothing to this other than bad news to Chrissy because she's pissed off at Yandy. This entire season, Kimbella's going to be playing this little fiddle. She's going to be the bone collector. She's going to take the bone, but she's going to collect the wrong bone because, as Jonathan says, her one digit IQ, I was going to give her a negative, you know, her negative IQ, is doing too much because she is now going to the person who put her hands on her to now talk about Yandy because she, I know Kimbella wants Chrissy to whoop Yandy's ass. She wants Yandy to feel the same punches that her naked ass, her ass, spread eagle, her vagina that was shown to the entire world fell when Chrissy decked her twice and almost kicked her in the damn face when she thought she was still looking too pretty. Now, Kimbella decides to take the wrong bone to Chrissy, talking about how when they were talking about when her, Sin, and Jonathan were sitting down, they were talking about Chrissy's house and going to foreclosure, and how Yandy says that the reason why I got into foreclosure is because she wasn't managing them. That was a bull-faced lie. Yes, Yandy threw shade at Chrissy by saying that this situation started in 2010, and that was around the same time when she stopped managing them. But she did not actually come out of the woodworks and say that that was the reason why their house foreclosed. Bitch, you are... Kimbella's pissing me off. She needs to shut the fuck up. And I feel like Chrissy should turn and just knock her again one more time. I used to feel bad that Chrissy put her hands on her because I felt like Emily B should have been the one to deliver that message. However, now that she's doing all this, Chrissy needs to hit her ass again because she's doing too much. She knows that Chrissy does not see for Yandy, and she's using it to put more battery into her back instead of fighting her own damn battles. Your kids play together, for God's sakes. Kimbella, she pisses me off. Go find your man in his fake dentures and go sit there and kiss him and figure it out, because right now you're doing the absolute most. The next thing we got is Hot 97 with DJ Drewski Papoose and this new person named Fresher. Fresher is not my cup of tea right now. He's an attractive man to me. He's a handsome dude. He's not ugly. However, he is not my cup of tea right now because I feel like he's going to bring the storyline where he's hitting on his arties, but he got this 20-year-old relationship that he had with this woman with her kids and going to have her acting crazy on TV, going after the girl as if he's not the one fucking up. But from what I see, he's talented. He had music that he did with Remy Ma, Cardi B. But now he's looking to start his own, I think, record label. But I've never heard of him before. Ever. I've never heard of him. This is the first time I've heard of him. So I don't know what he's done outside of the names that he dropped. I don't know financially where he's at. He might be the next Rich Pennies, Rich Pesos. He might end up having all these different artists and just fucks them and never really gets through with it. Because I know Cisco was working with artists. Peter Guz was working with artists. Rachel was working with artists. DJ Self was working with artists. And I've never seen any artists that they've actually like put out there like that. DJ Self had the opportunity to put Cardi out there. And he lost that chance because he told her that her music was garbage. Now we got this Janeski girl, but I'll get to that later. But here's Fresher and Papoose in this with DJ Drewski. Of course, Papoose has got bars. He's a legend when it comes to the rap scene. He raps, Fresher introduces himself, raps as well, and we let that scene go. And Commander and Safari are making a video for their wedding because their wedding is in 3 weeks. And in comes Tahiri, and they're going to discuss this prenup situation that Tahiri put in Erica Mena's ear about discussing a prenup with Safari now that she's about to get married. Girl, I would not listen to my friend when it comes to what I want to do with a prenup in my relationship. Because at the end of the day, there's some things, unless we're fighting and stuff like that, there's some things that people are not privy to that happens behind closed doors. When it comes to prenuptial agreement, you have to assess the situation of your marriage. Now, I understand that when people break up, things can get really bad. And you have to be able to tell people's spirit to see if this type of individual has evilness within him to where they can, him or her, to where they can do something really janky to you if you guys end up having to separate. I don't know if Safari is that type. But I feel like Erica Mena can really assess the situation herself and decipher herself whether she needs a prenup or not. I don't think Tahiri should have even involved herself in that. But that's just me. Then We got Christy at the Lady Middleton meeting. She's now going to explain to these ladies the fact that even though she got into a foreclosure, they can still trust her with their money. Because truth be told, if you get into a foreclosure, bitch, I don't know if I want to give you anything. Not a cent. I don't want to trust you with anything that has to do with my finances, because it makes it look like you're not able to keep up with your own house issues. But Christy breaks down and lets them know that this happened through no fault of her own. And that basically Jimmy was the one who did this. Her name was on the deed of the house, but she didn't have anything to do with the bill, the accounting part of it. Now, I love that the Lady Millionaire people are not just taking her word for it because of her title and who she is. They are making an effort to ask questions and get some answers because their money is on the line. And old dude, I forgot his name, says that it's about $250,000 that's on the line right now. These women are investing and they're trying to flip homes and make money off of it. Probably $1 million type properties with all the people that are there to make money off of it. So they want to be able to trust her and that she'll make the right decision with all their money. And that's not like some kind of pyramid scheme or some shit like that. So she breaks down, everything's straight, and she leaves that situation on a good, you know, on a good note. Safari meets up with Papoose to discuss the prenup situation. And I love Papoose. He's wise. He's been married long enough to understand the intricacies of a relationship and how to have a healthy marriage. And Papoose basically lets him know that because of Erica Mena's past experience, he's going to have to prove himself and make sure that she's safe and she feels content in their relationship. Not just with the men that she had in the past, like Rich and Bow Wow or people who cheated on her, but also because we just had this recent situation with Safari and Gabby, where apparently he was out proposing to her in Jamaica, and the cheating scandal where he had to beg for her relationship back. You have put yourself in a position that makes her have doubts when it comes to trusting you. So yes, if she does feel like she needs a prenup to protect herself, you have to just go ahead and bite the bullet because you're the one who set that situation up. I love how Papu gave him advice on how to make sure that his relationship works and what to do to make it right. Not just saying, oh, you know what, she's crazy. Damn, I don't know why the fuck she wants to prenup. Ladies these days, they're crazy like that, you know. I love how he gives advice that's useful for you to actually be able to get something productive in your relationship, not just fucking it up for you, unlike Joe. Then we got Jonathan Janeski, the new beautiful girl. She looks like she's talented. So far what I've seen, I wouldn't call her Cardi B, but I think she's raw talent that if she's nurtured properly, she has the ability to probably move forward with her music career. Rich Pesos decides to show up, and Jonathan is deciding to introduce Janeski, to Rich to help her with her music career. Rich gets the feel from her. She lets Rich know that she, Fresher, with a PH, is trying to work with her, but he's trying to work with her in the sense of telling her that she needs to get butt shots and tit shots, and he wants to put her up in an apartment and basically have her like a side piece and stuff like that. And she's like, I'm not feeling that. I have my own studio. I have 40 music sitting on. I have things I've done that I want to start working. And she does have a pretty, you know, as far as a music background goes, she does have a little bit of an early starter and people that she worked with in the past. So she has some experience doing this. She just needs the right, I guess, team behind her. And Jonathan introducing her to Rich, maybe Rich can introduce her to somebody that can get her career kickstarted. I don't know. But the problem is Rich and Fresher know each other. And you don't want to step on somebody's toes, just like Cisco and DJ Self and Peter Guns. You don't want to step on somebody's toes. So that might be a little bit of a conflict, but we'll see how that goes. Then we got Yandy and Jonathan meet up at a nail shop. And of course, Kimbella comes up. And Yandy makes sure, and Jonathan makes sure to discuss the fact that Kimbella does have a motive being around Christy. Why else would you be around somebody who put their hands on you, bitch? Like, it makes sense. Kimbella, I don't know if Christy knows this, or maybe she hasn't just acknowledged it yet to our face. Christy has to know that Kimbella has something behind her outside of the whole connection they have with their men doing music together. Christy has to know that Kimbella being around her when her man is gone, even knowing that she put her hands on her, and every time she's around her, all she gets to do is talk about Yandy this and Yandy that and Yandy this, that there's a reason behind it. Hopefully Chrissy's able to peep it. I don't know. I don't see it yet because of how she acted when she met with Yandy and Jonathan's fragrance thingy, which I'll get to. But I hope she's getting that, because here is Yandy and Jonathan discussing it. And they're very right and they're very true. Yandy does throw jab and she does shade, but in this particular situation, Kimbella's bullface lying, and she's doing it because she's mad at Yandy. She really is angry at her for Yandy making her look some type of way when it came to the children. She's angry with her because she feels like Yandy hasn't been there for her as a friend. She's angry with her for a variety of reasons, and she really wants Yandy to feel the frustration that she's feeling because Yandy's not giving her emotions any life. She's not giving her emotions any truth. She's not even acknowledging any of the problems that Kimbella have with her. So Kimbella's so frustrated with being ignored that she wants somebody to put their hands on her without it being her. So after Chrissy puts her hands on Yandy, she'll come back and say, you know what? I think that we can move on now. I feel like that's what she's doing, because Kimbella is missing a few screws. She does some dumb shit sometimes. I'm sorry. And I used to think that she was slow as a motherfucker when she first came on the show because of how she talked. She's a woman with a child. Let her speak. And you like loud and you want to get up. Like the way she talked was slow as hell. I used to think she was slow. Anyway, the next thing, we got Safari and Erica Mena discussing the prenup situation, having dinner. And Safari basically lets Erica Mena know that he is willing to sign whatever if it means that she ends up trusting him. Erica Mena makes a decision that I would never make in this situation, which is agree not to have a prenup. If I have any inkling, anything that comes up in the past that lets me know that you may have cheated with the whole Gabby situation, I would get a prenup for the simple fact that I have had a red flag. That's just me. Hopefully nothing bad happens between the two of them, but I would get that damn prenup. Erica's better than me because I would have him sign anything, like he said. Then we got Janeski and Fresher meeting up again at some dinner. He got champagne. He's obviously flirting with her, licking that thick-ass lips. I have a thing for lips. Like, I have a thing for guys with thick lips because it's full. The upper lip and the bottom lip are there. You just want to suckle on them. You just want to, like, play with them. You just want to just lick them. You just picture all the different things they can do for you. His lip did look ashy, though. But they were thick and ashy. You know, I could just put some Vaseline or some Carmax on them and just still use them. But anyway, he's sitting here at this table with some champagne with her. He's flirting with her. After he had told us in the first scene, we saw him, that he's with a girl, Jen, who's been with him and his ride or die for 20-something years. But here he is flirting with his potential artist. And he does mention that Jen knows about her and feels like she's going to get them far. But you out here flirting with her. And the thing that pissed me off about Fresher is that he's telling this beautiful girl that she needs to go and get butt shots and get titty shots to objectify herself. Instead of people paying attention to her talent, they're going to pay attention to her body. But honestly, this whole thick body, this big-ass excess booty, it was great when Nicki Minaj first came out. It was popping then. Nowadays, it just looks so overdone. That shit ain't cute no more. Hell, Kim Michelle is trying to take her shit out. Like, there's danger in doing that shit to yourself. It is not cute. Even on the Kardashians, it just don't look normal. They don't even look like the way that they look like when they were born. Like, fuck out of here. Don't do anything to that girl. She has enough titties. Her face is beautiful. She, you know, what happened to push-up bras? Like, fuck, I don't think that he should have her actually go under the knife and physically alter herself, because unlike him, she has risks that come along with doing that. Don't tell her to do that to herself and as if that's going to get her far. I have a lot of females that come up on this show that they got butt shots, titty shots, face shots, lip shots, eye shots, you know, arm shots, everything under the sun. And hell, even change your skin color and their career still has not gone anywhere. So that is not, that's to say that that's not what gets you far. Talent also matters. Rima didn't do shit to herself that drastic. Hell, she looks beautiful right now. She don't have no ass shots. And, you know, I haven't seen it. Her butt is not that big for me to think she has ass shots. And her career has been booming. I don't think that people need to use that and have this norm, perpetuate the norm that's objectifying women as a way for them to get seen in the rap scene. That's stupid. I didn't like that he did that. I just didn't appreciate that. As a woman, I didn't appreciate that shit. Then we got Jonathan's fragrance release party. And Chrissy, Kimbella, Jujubee, Sin, all of them are invited to this scene. Jonathan, according to Yandy, did this entire launch, created this fragrance, which looked like it smelled bomb as a motherfucker, by himself. This is a hard work and effort that he put into his work, his craft, and I'm very happy that it's now seeing light, because I feel like success is something I'm never going to down anybody for getting. Get your money where you're talented as. Get, you know, become a self-starter. Do what you need to do to get far in life, and I'll be supportive. I'm not a hater. I'll love anything that you do that gets you where you need to be. But here they are, this fragrance party, they're discussing the situation. Sin makes it clear in front of Kimbella that she was the one who actually asked about the foreclosure situation as it pertains to Chrissy. Jujubee is on the background speculating, seeing this entire conversation, not saying anything because she's observing. And Jonathan says Yandy didn't really say it. I didn't see Yandy, unless I'm missing something and they cut and paste something, I didn't see Yandy like go in and let have on Chrissy. Yeah, she threw shade by saying, 2010, that was around the same time when I stopped managing. That's shade, yes, but it wasn't like she was really going in. In this particular situation, Kimbella completely exaggerated it, and I love Jonathan's read saying that she got one digit IQ. I think it's -0 right now. But for me, Kimbella, I feel like, is now grasping at straws. She's going to take every little thing, she's going to exaggerate it because she wants Chrissy and Yandy to have a problem. Kimbella probably doesn't know how to fight. when she was trying to defend Yandy, that other girl that was copying everything that Yandy was doing when she was supposed to be DC's assistant. Kimbella didn't know shit. I don't think Kimbella's a fighter. I don't think she's a fighter. When Chrissy was putting her hands on her, she was on the floor running around with her coochie out and her legs spread open, were spread eagle, no panties on, her National Forest out. We just saw everything, her hair out. I didn't see her do anything. So I feel like she wants Chrissy to do her dirty work. Chrissy hears the conversation, comes and talk about what's the rah-rah going on. They bring it up and she says that she knows Yandy and she knows Jonathan. Kimbella tried to put it like Jonathan was talking shit. Jonathan's like, I wasn't talking shit. Chrissy was like, looking at Jonathan like, I know your person. Jonathan, I never say shit about you. And Jonathan did not say shit about her. And then she said, Yandy, you're lying, you're lying. And everybody around who was there saying, no, Yandy didn't say that. I don't know if I missed something, but it seemed like in a split second, Chrissy goes raw and decides to go off on Yandy. Don't talk to me like that because I'll whoop your ass. I'll whoop your ass. I'm saying to myself, like, I don't think Yandy did anything that was that crazy. You know, she rose her hand. She didn't, like, you know, poke her in her face like, bitch, this, da 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 da. She didn't do any of that. She was trying to get some understanding between the both of them, saying that, I know, Chrissy, you just walked into the situation. You really don't know what happened because you're going off of what Kimbella said. Look at the individual who's bringing you news, the person you didn't put your hands on type situation. She is not to be trusted. And you got Sin here who's saying that she's the one who asked about it. You get Jonathan here who was there saying that what Kimbella is saying didn't occur. Kimbella's acting like Jonathan saying the truth is such a huge, that Jonathan's taking Yandy's side is coming off that way, but you're lying. You're lying. You're telling a bull-faced lie. What you want Jonathan to do? Ignore the fact that you're lying and yet let Yandy get attacked for something that didn't really occur the way that you portrayed it? Kimbella needs to shut the fuck up because I feel like this entire season she's going to be after Yandy. She's going to be Yandy. I'm curious as to what's going to happen when these scenes are being played in the reunion and what Kimbella's going to say, because she wants everybody to think Yandy's fake, which she does some fake shit too. But everybody in this freaking, like, franchise at some point does some fake shit because the drama is what we feed off of. The drama is what we see. The drama is what got us talking about the situation in the first place. This is a show and they have to put on a show to keep making the money they're making. So Kimbella, I feel like, is a little bit more for her, to where she's going out of her way to behave this way. She's pissing me the fuck off, bitch. I don't like her. She needs to go back into whatever the hell she was at and keep it going. She needs to go and find her man, take those dentures out, and have him have fun with her with no teeth. Right now, what she's doing with Yandy is unnecessary. She's vengeful and she's vindictive, and I don't like how she's operating right now. But the next episode trailer that showed up basically seems like, again, just like Chrissy fucked up the relationship between Yandy and Jim Jones when her and Yandy kind of got into it. It seems like that may be a scenario that occurs again, because it seems like there's somebody that is familiar with Yandy and Chrissy that Chrissy is working with financially, that Yandy may have worked with in the past. And it seems like Yandy was talking to somebody and that person relayed the information that Chrissy also may have fucked up that money situation too. I don't know if it's true, but that was what I was getting when I saw the trailer for it. I think next week they'll clarify that for us more. But right now, Kimbella right now is the black sheep of the show for me. Jonathan Reed is on point. First it was the fake hair. Oh, I see you're wearing human hair and I'm not synthetic. Then it's the IQ. Oh, let's hear you explain shit with your, you know, one digit IQ. His reads are on point and I'm here for it. Jujubee, I don't know what she's bringing to the show yet, but we'll see what happens. Safari and Erica Mena, their storyline is dwindling for me. This fresher guy, I'm waiting to see what happened. I feel like his baby mom is going to be more entertaining than his ass. So I can't wait to see her, because she's going to be next episode. She's going to be there and she's going to try to go after Janeski. So we'll see why or what the storyline is. It probably means that something is going on between him and her and she found out about it, or she's uncomfortable with it and she's reacting. Anyway, please like, subscribe, ring the notification bell. Check out my next review for the final Love & Hip Hop reunion Hollywood. I'm going to talk about it because there's a lot of shit I'm going to talk about it. I like how this ended. I like how everything tied together. And I have a few things that I want to touch on before we move forward to the next Love & Hip Hop Miami, y'all. Love y'all. Bye.